Welcome all our distinguished guests this afternoon for our Food4Talk Conference. Held in this fabulous building, coincidentally, this palace was designed by the very same architect, Michel Polak, a Swiss architect, who redesigned Henri Nestlé's own residence 106 years ago in Vevey. So what a coincidence that is. With us here this afternoon, we have MEPs, representatives from NGOs, EU institutions. Also with us, I am delighted to say, our host this afternoon, Executive Vice President and Head of Europe, Middle East and North Africa, Luis Cantarell. Thank you very much for inviting us all to be here. And one thing uniting each and every one of us, food lovers. My husband reliably ensures that informs me that I am bred from a family of Labradors. That is that great big fat greedy dog. And I can guarantee I have to run very fast to try and work off all that food that I do eat. We are here today to discuss food, a crucial subject, and what promises to be a lively discussion of what we are and where we are today in 2016 in terms of our relationship with it. So 150 years this June, in fact, since the birth of Nestlé, the world is an incredibly different place 150 years on. Producers, distributors, consumers, all changing their habits at such an incredible fast pace. I hope you've had time to visit the exhibition outside. You will get a little bit more time later on as well, because that is a fascinating insight into Nestlé's 150-year past, but also its future, where we're heading. And I'm keen, as I'm sure you are, over the next hour, to hear more from the experts, the eyes that they will give, their vision into where we are going, the food thinkers and experts within Europe. The overriding theme that we are discussing, though, today is how food management can be a really powerful tool to make this world a better place. And that's ultimately what we're all trying to achieve. We've all got to live here, and as you will hear, our population is growing so rapidly. So on the menu this afternoon, an amuse-bouche from a millennial author who has studied our growing obsession with food. Then our entree this afternoon, a governmental advisor gives us his thoughts on food security, waking up to the fact, as I was just saying, that we are living on a planet that is becoming incredibly crowded. For our main course, how we can find harmony between sustainable economic development and societal well-being, a big question. Businesses having a key role to play in all of that. And then for our dessert, an architect and writer who asks us to really ponder how on earth we actually feed an entire city. Thought-provoking, really insightful. I think you'll find it fascinating. So over the next hour, we really want to get everyone thinking. We want to get you engaged. And of course, social media is the answer to all that. Twitter, we want to get it a buzz. So if you are Twitter users, if you've got your phones at the ready, please do submit your questions as long as you can get that signal, that crucial signal. Use the hashtag, and the hashtag is hashtag NestTalks, capital N, capital T. You can see it right at the top of the graphic here. Hashtag NestTalks and at Nestlé EU. And don't forget that if you are directing a specific question to a specific speaker, all through the next hour, we will have their hashtags up here on the screens for you if you want to connect with them via Twitter. If they don't get the time to answer your questions while we're up on stage, they will be here later on for the cocktail reception straight afterwards. And also, if you've directed it to their Twitter handle, of course, they'll be able to engage with you. And that's really important for all you people who are interested in this gastronomic journey. So let's start it with a simple question to start us off. What is food porn? And why are these young millennials so into it, so obsessed by food porn? It is gaining huge momentum, and our first speaker is something of an expert. If you want to ask her a direct question, here is her Twitter handle, at Eve Turow Paul. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the author of A Taste of Generation Yum and a creature of the millennium era, the millennial era, yeah, herself. Ladies and gentlemen, Eve Turow Paul.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. I'm excited to kick things off today. Did you know that there are over 200 million photos tagged food on Instagram? Young people today are obsessed with food. My name is Eve Turow Paul, and I'm here to talk to you today about millennials and food culture. And I'm hoping you walk away with a better understanding of the emotional wants and needs of this young generation that is driving this food trend. About 5 years ago, I set out to answer a very basic question, which is, why are young people today taking photos of their lunch? Why are people looking at photos of other people's lunch? I was a writing student in graduate school in New York City, and I saw that with every moment, my peers were talking about a great meal that they had at some underground dinner or a hot new chef. People were judging each other based on food choices. And I thought to myself, why are these recession-dented 20-somethings spending their discretionary income on truffle cheese instead of laundry, which they should have been doing? And to answer this question, I set out on a journey that took me for about 4 years across the United States. I talked to young people who make lists of restaurants they want to try, I talked to individuals who cook elaborate meals just for themselves, and I talked to people who said, "Mom and Dad, I'm really sorry. I don't want to be a lawyer or a banker. I really just want to be an organic farmer or a brewer." And then I reached out to the leading luminaries in the food scene and spoke with Anthony Bourdain, Michael Pollan, Mark Bittman, and so many more about their own theories on what is happening today. And then I also dug deep into academic journals to see what's been done researching this on tangential subjects in psychology, sociology, anthropology that would help me gain a better understanding of this phenomenon. So I'm going to be sharing a bit of those findings with you today. First and foremost, there are a lot of millennials. So I'm talking about a quarter of the global population. It's 24% of the EU. Because that is so general, I also want you to keep in mind that when I say millennial, it's really more a mindset than anything else. It's about the effect of growing up in the 21st century. One of the things that makes us so incredibly unique is that we spend so much money on food. And this is global. 6 in 10 millennials go out to eat at least once a week, twice the rate of baby boomers. Millennials go to bed thinking about what they're going to eat the next morning. They're watching food television and writing their friends about it. We're also getting political about our food, right? We're demanding cage-free eggs and organic. We're starting to think about, where did this actually come from that's in front of me? Oh, right, it was grown in the ground. Who was it grown by? How did it get to me? I wrote my book and did the research on the United States, but once it came out, I received calls from all around the world of people saying, this is happening here too. And ultimately, that shouldn't have surprised me as much as it did, because my results should actually make sense in a global setting. Technology is really what separates millennials from any generation that's come before us. We grew up with one foot in and one foot out of the technological boom. We're the guinea pigs for what it's like to be raised with screens and clicks. I still remember learning the Dewey Decimal System to find my book in the library, but then going to computer class to learn how to make a really great PowerPoint presentation. Some anthropologists today call us cyborgs. They think that my generation, us digital natives, we cannot exist without our cell phones. We go into a panicked state if we are disconnected from any moment in time. So why is this techie generation gravitating towards food? What I began to understand throughout my years of research is that young people today are using food as a format of anti-technology. Now, there are a lot of things that can be anti-technology. You can go on a hike, adult coloring books are taking off, that is also an anti-technology. But there are 4 distinct things that food offers that other anti-technologies do not. And that is community, sensory stimulation, identity formation, and control. And I'm going to walk through those 4 in a bit more detail, and then also talk about how all of this relates to sustainability. First, food is community. We all know, right, that sending a text or G-chatting with somebody is not nearly as satisfying as actually seeing someone face to face. And you're starting to see young people reacting to this, using technology to facilitate offline time. Right, so here in Brussels, there's actually a website called Book a Local, where you can book a chef for an underground dinner or a friend's party. People are trying to forge emotional connections with others. They're getting to know chefs in a whole new way, reading chef memoirs, following blogs, watching cooking competitions on TV. We're going to restaurants and we will happily share a table with other people. We also want to share our dishes with other people. This is all about creating face-to-face time with our farmers as well. Related to community is also experience, right? Millennials are saying, I don't need things, I want to do something. I want a memory that's just mine. I want something that's unique that I'm going to remember. And this is a value that they're also passing down to their kids. One of the words I heard over and over again during my interviews was the word tangible. The subjects I was interviewing, they just wanted something they could actually see and feel that wasn't going to disappear if their computer crashed. There's something viscerally unsatisfying about ending your day and you say, hey honey, what'd you do? Oh, I sent email. Right? Today, if you say to somebody, well, I'm a butcher or I'm a plumber or I'm a furniture maker, things that were blue collar. Now you get a response of like, dude, you actually do something. You end your day and you've created something. People want something that is real, that they can wholeheartedly feel. They want to dig their hand in dirt. They want to dig their hands into a bowl of raw meat and actually make the meatballs themselves, hear it sizzle in the pan. One of the things that I think is most often said about millennials is that we're narcissistic. And when I started this project, I thought, are we really that bad? And after several years of research, I can tell you, yes, we are. We really are that narcissistic, but it is for good reason. We are branding ourselves all the time. You need to brand yourself differently for LinkedIn to get a job than you do for OkCupid to get a date, than you do for Facebook to show your friends how awesome you are. We are the ultimate self-branders. And as food has become imbued with all of these other labels, such as sustainable, organic, fair trade, we're using food as an example of our values. So the minute you take a picture of that awesome quinoa bowl that you made for yourself and post it online, you're trying to project something about yourself. It's the same way that my parents' generation held a certain music album under their arm. So what are young people trying to say with these food photos? They're trying to say, I'm educated. I know about organic. I know about GMOs. They're trying to say, I'm environmentally conscious. Guys, look how altruistic I am with my carrot top pesto over here. Hashtag no food waste. One of the best things I've read is that foodie children are the hot new accessory. So mothers will be like, well, my son eats kimchi. And that's how they're trying to one-up one another. Another part of this is we want to appear well-traveled. Again, we're the first generation with the 24/7 news cycle, with the internet. We need to appear as though we know things beyond our own circle. In short, what we eat is not about diet anymore. It is about who you are. It's about what you stand for. And the real brand loyalties that you see today have to do with value systems, not the actual product. Not only are we defining ourselves by what we do eat, but also by what we don't eat. You've probably heard someone say, or at least read on a profile, I'm a vegan dentist from Ohio. I am a paleoanthropologist from Miami. Right? And these restrictive eating diets, they come with a value system. Not like our parents when they would, no one would say, I'm a Weight Watcher, I'm an Atkins dieter, right? But today, veganism, paleoism, gluten-free, they bring other things with them, such as caring about the environment or a certain philosophy. One of the most interesting interviews that I did for my book was with a young woman who very clearly told me that she had suffered from anorexia throughout her childhood, and today chooses very specifically what she will and will not eat. For her, it's all organic, it's all local. And she said that the same sense of control she once felt by not eating at all, she now feels by choosing very carefully what she will and will not eat. And for me, it was kind of an aha moment. So I went back to the academic journals to see if I could find any research that had been done in this, and found several studies, specifically in the gluten-free, vegan, and locavore communities, with language that mirrored pro-anorexia websites, where a lot of the conversation was about how to establish some sense of control. Now, why would this be? Well, it also turns out that we're the most anxious and depressed generation on record. Generation Z, the generation younger than us, is actually kind of inching up towards us with online bullying as the main culprit there. The reasons for this anxiety and depression differ depending on where you are in the world, But generally speaking, it revolves around a lack of trust in government, a fear of climate change, and an insecurity about technology. I mean, do you know really how your iPhone works? Do you really know if you've been hacked? What can you do about mitigating climate change? And these feelings are resulting in people that feel completely anxious, that lay awake at night wondering what kind of environment they're going to be leaving for their kids. But even if a young person doesn't know if they can get a job, doesn't know if they can buy a house, has no idea what's going to happen with the environment, the least that they want to be able to do is know what it is that they're eating. That's why they're calling for simple ingredients. They're rejecting GMOs because they don't understand them. They want to break things down to the most simple of parts. Young people are calling for transparency and simplicity. And this is in food and outside of food. You can see this also in the political sphere around the world, right? Young people today just want to break things down into digestible bits, pun intended. So, millennials are looking for brands that help us do that, that help us cut through the chaos of our lives, that simplify things, and that align with our value systems. It's not enough anymore for a brand to create a valuable product. Now, brands need to help their customers live up to their ideals for a healthy self and a healthy world. And so the question really becomes, why are young people taking photos of their food? Because it's helping us form our identities, helping us put us in control, creating sensory stimulation, et cetera. And so I think I want you to keep in mind for the rest of the day, the rest of the presentations, what role do those things have to play in creating a sustainable future? How does sustainability help people feel like they're more in control of their lives? How to create food that's closer to home so that people can actually interact with it in all new ways? Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Eve. That's great. If you've had questions that you've been putting via Twitter to Eve, she will answer them a little later on or collar her during the cocktail reception. I'm certainly getting trouble trying to get a signal in here, so I couldn't tweet, but normally I would. It'll be out there in the stratosphere a little later on. We move now to our entree, a call for action from the chief scientific advisor to the UK government's Food Standards Agency, and a serious warning to all of us of the consequences of not waking up to the reality of food security, making it a top priority. The world is changing dramatically, as we all know, and none more so in the size of its population. If we don't wake up soon and realise the effect that this extraordinary population growth is having on each and every one of us, it will possibly be too late. How can we play our part as individuals, as businesses? Well, we've all got it at our fingertips. It is that magic thing. It is data, big data. And it's all about our willingness to share it. Again, if you have a question for our next speaker, at GuyPoppy1. So, ladies and gentlemen, don't forget to use the hashtag NestTalks, capital N, capital T, and any questions will go directly to him. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Professor of Ecology and Governmental Scientific Advisor, Professor Guy Poppy.
Thank you. Thank you. So I'm your entree, and actually, I was trying to find some images of entree, and being involved in government and also in a university, I had to be very careful about Google imaging of food porn, as you can imagine. But I did, but I did manage to find these images. Everybody in this room is a leader of some sorts, and I had the privilege of going on a course where the plays of Shakespeare were used to try and create new leaders, and the Muse of Fire, or the Call to the Imagination speech, is often used to train people to actually think about a future which you might want, or an image or a picture, based on relatively limited props. And that's what The Muse of Fire was about in Henry V as a play. And I ask you all in the room here today to actually try to imagine a future food system, even though you might be starting in relatively limited props, that actually leads up to that inspiration, that call to the imagination. And I pushed the wrong button, that's farther. Can I? Okay. And so I have a vision. My vision is based on the fact that I actually currently have two jobs. One is as an advisor to the Food Standards Agency, which focuses more on issues to do with safety and standards. And the job as a professor of ecology at university is much more about sustainably producing enough food. And therefore, I am in a situation to talk about food security, because food security requires all of those things to be delivered. That's not the vision we want. We certainly don't want that sort of vision. And that's why Sir John Beddington, when he was the Her Majesty's Government's Chief Scientific Advisor in the UK, coined the term the perfect storm. The perfect storm, sometimes people call this the nexus, but people have got nexus overload now. They don't like talking about nexuses. But the perfect storm was using a date of 2030. So it wasn't just the millennials who would be worried about it. It would be older people too, who might still be alive in 2030. Let's hope we are. And it introduced the fact that actually needed 50% more food, 50% more energy, and 30% more water. And that is against a backdrop of the climate changing as well. And what he argued was, if we don't address this perfect storm now, then the consequences in the future will be very great. And we've seen some of the signs of these. Many people believe that, for instance, Arab Spring, the last thing which drove it was the basic food prices, commodities going up, which actually made people lose confidence in governments. So therefore, the perfect storm, we've seen signs of it, we do need to start addressing it, and that's what I'm going to talk about a little bit more today. One-tenth of the people that have ever lived on planet Earth are alive today. A quarter of them are millennials, but the other 75% are not. I'm not a millennial, but during my lifetime, the population has dramatically increased. I remember literally 18 months ago speaking about the consequences of 7 billion people being alive, and we're heading now towards 8 billion. When I gave that talk, I don't like being a bit of a kind of, oh dear, life's not looking good. I gave a talk to a group of fine artists. The fine arts got up at the end and said, thank you very much for that talk. I'm going home now to drink two bottles of wine. You've made me very depressed. And I said, why is that? And they said, well, what can we do about it? They produced some paintings associated with the consequences of 7 billion people. One of them produced a painting. When you went up close, every single image behind it was a QR code. When you looked on that QR code, it went to a page of evidence about consequences of 7 billion people. I said, that going viral, that image, that amount of information is the equivalent of me giving thousands of talks. So you can contribute too. We all have a role to play. We can all stand up to the call to the imagination and do something. What does that mean in reality? Well, Stephen Hawking, the very famous physicist, said one of the ways that mankind can survive is to find another planet we can colonize. The other option is to try and do something with the planet that we have. One thing that's very clear, the amount of land that we can grow food on is not going to grow at the same rate as the population. And what we see here is between 1950 and 2050, 30% of the land available in 1950 per person to feed you compared to now. That's not also including changes in nutritional and dietary preferences, which can make this situation a little bit more challenging. You are probably beginning to think, no wonder that artist wanted some wine now. But the final thing I want to demonstrate is climate change. We all know that climate change is an issue which is going to affect productivity. In red, parts of the world which, if we don't produce new varieties, change cropping techniques, etc., will be less productive in 2080. In green, areas where it won't. A real global north, global south divide. Most urbanisation, most population increases in the red areas. The green areas, that isn't the case. So therefore, this problem of climate change and increasing population is making our challenge very hard. And Peter, who is speaking after me, was speaking at the EAT Forum in Sweden last week. Why was that important? Well, what is clear is the food system is currently broken, but actually there's no point having a revolution, which people might like. Revolutions never always end up happily. What we need is directed, rapid evolution from where we are to where we need to be. And Peter will talk more about the role that businesses, etc., can play in that after me. So what do we need by food security? Hundreds of different definitions. I like a picture. A picture here shows you to be food secure, you need four pillars. Actually, my colleagues in health and safety say chairs are more stable now with five legs, but let's stick to the days when four legs on a chair was quite stable. And we have food being available, people having access to it, people being able to utilise that food, either it's nutritious and safe to eat, and it's a stable system. So you're food secure today and tomorrow. And you need all those pillars to be in place to be food secure. And I'm arguing, and what I'm calling for you today, the call to the imagination, I'm calling you all that anyone who has data, if we share that data, we can rise to this challenge more. Because sharing data will actually enable us to answer and get early warning signals or actions to address those pillars. The first pillars in terms of how do we produce more food and more sustainably, there's been lots of reports on that. And one of the interesting things, and Peter will pick this up again, is we've got to produce more food per unit area of land whilst enhancing the natural capital that will be raised by the next talk. What we mean by that is we get from planet Earth more than just food. We get water, we get clean air, we lock up carbon and all those sorts of things. And we've got to produce food without harming those things too much, because what's been happening, I know this is a complicated diagram, I'm sorry about that, but actually, you've got to put, as a professor, occasionally I've got to give a figure maybe nobody understands. Okay? But this one is, if we focus on the purple petals are things that you get from the environment, food, water, etc. And the other petals, this comes from the World Bank's ecosystem service language, are the things which help that occur. That's an agricultural system, that's a tropical rainforest. Massive difference. Agriculture, we get loads, not very much supporting it. Tropical rainforests get very little load supporting it. What we're calling for is not making things less productive, but making sure the other things are there. That's the challenge we've all got to reach in terms of making food more sustainable and more resilient. But what about the other pillars? Because actually there's no point just having two, it's difficult to sit on, and actually four is more stable. Okay, so we do need to think about making food accessible to people and that it is safe and nutritious. And that's difficult. This is the globalised food system. In the UK, we get food from 186 countries around the world. Being able to work on whether the food's safe, whether it's a reliable supply, whether it's nutritious, whether it's fraud, is difficult in that complex picture. We also have the issue about Africa is actually 40% of the population by the end of the century will be in Africa. How do we make it so that Africa either has food available, it's growing it, or the food is accessible to people in Africa? That's an issue that obviously requires clever thinking, clever imagination. And coupled with that, megacities. And Carolyn, in the last talk, we'll talk about urbanisations. Massive moves from people from the rural landscape towards the cities. How do we make people in cities food secure? And my solution to you all is big data, sharing data, can enable us to at least propose possible solutions. 90% of the world's existing data has been created in the last 2 years. But data has no value until data is turned into information that you can act upon. And therefore, if we share data together, we are more likely to come up with what it means and what we can do with it. So therefore, my call to you all is to share data. And I will give you an example. The Food Standards Agency has been working in Northern Ireland with 75 companies that supply animal feed. Those 75 companies all collected data by themselves to see whether the animal feed had chemical or microbial contamination in it, which would then scale up through the food chain. By sharing the data, they got early warning signals of problems, didn't have to do a recall, saved a lot of money not doing the recall, and actually protected the sector. They now spend more money as individual companies collecting data because they can see the value of it. And I know that Nestlé in Pakistan have done a similar thing in terms of making their milk safer and therefore improving the food security aspects in Pakistan relating to milk by sharing that data. So please open up the data sets, let's share and work on generating the signals together. And to give you a way in which actually anyone using some of the social media out there are effectively opening up their data immediately. The millions of Twitter users in the world are effectively telling you loads of information. And we at the Food Standards Agency now are actually using that data to give real-time data on how people behave in their kitchens. Because you might be giving advice about how to do something based on a focus group you worked on 10 years ago. It gives live feeding on what people are doing. We've used it also to link about whether you can begin to detect a foodborne outbreak with potential practices locally. So you can combine sort of TripAdvisor and various other means like that to link all these things together. And we've also been looking at food fraud using big social data. Let me give you a real-world example. In the last 30 seconds, it's gone very red there, is norovirus. We did some work with young people, old people, mainly the young people helped us. I didn't know that hashtag bath means to throw up, apparently. But if you put hashtag bath and various other things into Twitter, you can then predict norovirus outbreaks 2 or 3 weeks before it's picked up in a hospital. Why? Because people start to put it out there very early on before people start going into GPs and hospitals. What might you do about that? Well, if norovirus, one of the problems is the spread through non-food means, that's why in cruise ships you have big problems once a few people get it, is that we can then advise the hospitals and advise the schools to improve the communication about washing hands and other hygienic behaviour to stop the escalation of that. So this is a very good way of actually capturing information that's out there. So for food security, we need to address all those pillars. It's flashing and I must finish, and we therefore need open and shared data.
Thank you. Thank you. Fascinating discussion there from Guy Poppy. And as you can see, the data is coming in. Guy will definitely endeavour to answer the questions that are coming in via Twitter, via social media. Keep that data going out there. And for those of you who aren't so familiar with British or American terms, bath is to vomit. So that's how the norovirus got detected. Thank you very much. Insightful. We're moving on now to our main course, where we talk about hashtag bath. Global leaders, they've got their heads together, thrashed out agreements on many a subject, Paris included. Our sustainable development goals are targets that we all know we should be focusing on. But where are these targets when it comes to the one thing that we know we do definitely need for day-to-day survival? Food. What are the targets? Are we clear where we're all going, what we should be doing? It seems, bizarrely, that we are not at all clear. And it's businesses like Nestlé that really do need to take up the reins. The consequences, if we do not, as our next speaker will outline, are dire. Dishing up our main course today, President and CEO of the World Business Council for Sustainable Development. And among his many current assignments, he is an ambassador against hunger for the United Nations World Food Programme. And yet, despite the uncertainty with which he looks at and analyses everything every day, he is a self-declared optimist, you'll be pleased to hear. Any direct questions to him, his hashtag, not the easiest. The handle is at MPB underscore WBCSD, which stands for the World Business Council of Sustainable Development. Please, ladies and gentlemen, welcome Peter Bakker.
Thank you, Lucy. Thank you, Lewis. Happy birthday. It's amazing to be here in such a distinguished room. I've never been asked to give a talk as the main course. I understand why it's me, but still... Who of you is of business? Can I see a raise of hands? Who of you is from government? Who are you of you are from NGOs? Not too many. Academics. Just interested parties. Good. Great. Great to see you all. I'll talk about business, which I've learned last week in Stockholm is not the easiest word to talk about in the food space. Because trust in business, unfortunately, Lewis, is rather low at times. Sustainability is one of those other words that's not the easiest to talk about, because before you know it, it gets rather depressing. So let's get that out of the way first. The world is in trouble. It doesn't matter where you look in the world, you will see trouble. Refugees, climate change, elections, there's Brussels, obviously. Terrible things are happening. And if you summarize it, the systems that we operate are broken. And as Guy so clearly said, the system of food is clearly very broken. I'm an ambassador against hunger. Against hunger. Every 6 seconds, a child dies from hunger. Another one just died. I have 13 minutes to talk to you. 130 children will die during my talk. There is 2.5 billion people overweight. There are now more obese people in the world than there are people going to bed hungry, not knowing whether they wake up tomorrow. And then in the middle of it all, a third of the food that we produce, we either throw away or we don't get it off the land to the market to serve to the people who need it. So if you want to talk to me about a system that is broken, tell me why this is not. So we need to fix it. So what do we need to do? Business is not very good at depressive speeches. I have to apologize if you like them. I'm the wrong guy. But two actually very good things happened last year. In my belief, this is probably where the optimist comes in, 10 years from now, we'll look back at 2015 and we'll come to the conclusion that was a historic year where breakthrough agreements were put in place. The Paris Agreement will change climate change. The move to a low-carbon society is now inevitable. You can believe in climate change, you cannot believe in climate change. If you're in business, in government, running a city or an NGO, we will now move to a low-carbon world. 2 degrees warming, 1.5 degree warming, they are set in stone. We're going to get there. The SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals. Everybody, anyone who does not know what SDGs are? You can't say that in Brussels, I guess, right? So you all do. 17 goals, 169 targets, a roadmap for how we want to develop the world until 2030. All aspects are covered. Poverty eradication, as well as climate change, water, cities, all everything you can think about is in this one comprehensive agenda. We do not need to talk about what a sustainable development is anymore. It's in those 17 goals. A fabulous framework, bit hard to action at times, but a fabulous framework still. What we think in business is that we cannot keep track of 17 goals, 169 targets all the time. We'll think in systems. So the world has an energy system, the world has city systems, the world has food systems. Those will be changed and made sustainable, and as we do, we will deliver against the SDGs. If you create a sustainable food system, you directly touch upon 9 of the 17 SDGs. And Johan Rockström last week in Stockholm actually quite convincingly made the case that indirectly you will touch all of them. But what we need Johan and his friends to deliver is simpler language. 2 degrees, I shout 2 degrees anywhere in the world these days and people know this guy is talking climate change. What do I shout when I talk food? I don't know, sugar is a word that some people are very excited about. Nutrition might be another word, but there is not one thing we can all strive for. So science needs to come up with much clearer language that actors in society can begin to drive this change. And in Stockholm last week, it was actually incredibly encouraging to see the EAT Forum. together with the Lancet, form a science committee. So what is now shaping is the IPCC for food. IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel of Climate Scientists that has created the robustness behind the 2 degrees in science, will now be formed in the Eat Lancet Commission. 30 scientists from Johan Rockström on his planetary boundary framework, all the way down to health and other related aspects of food. The first year, they will gather and assess all the science in the world. And at the end of next year, probably in June, the first draft will come out. The 5 targets for food will be appearing. And then we can all begin to act. Because contrary to the popular belief in society, it's not true that all the bad people in the world go to business and all the good guys go to government. It's very simple. Give business facts and it will act. As long as we don't know what we're going to aim for, we'll never aim for the right thing, that's for sure. And this is where science is so important. And once business has a plan on what needs to be acted upon, the game starts on how do we scale up these solutions. So we will need innovation. Lots of new technologies will come to bear. We need to change the economy. I'll talk about it for a second. And we need to very, very firmly work together. We've done this. Business has given incredibly important input into Paris, in the Paris Agreement, COP21. This particular example, 150 companies came together, worked on 9 business solutions. All these solutions together will reduce emissions by 65% of what is needed, according to science, to get on the 2-degree trajectory. We'll create up to $10 trillion of new economic growth. And will create 45 million jobs. If you fight climate change, you will touch 12 of the SDGs. If you build solutions like this for food, you will touch on a similar number of SDGs as well. So we need, if you go to Vevey, where Nestlé has his home, you cannot walk there without somebody talking to you about nutrition, health, and wellness. That's the big strategy. Next to shared value, I think. Those two are the big themes in the head office of Nestlé and spreading across the world. And this is very important, nutrition, health, and wellness. But linking it back to Eve's story, do we actually give consumers enough and clear enough information to make the right choices? Because yes, organic sounds good, but we don't have enough land to feed everybody organically is one of those issues. And maybe the millennials go first and in America, but what about equality in the rest of the world? So this is going to be an area where business will have to come up with an incredible amount of solutions, and it will. And business is, for those of you who are not in it, and the business people here are the minority, business is a relatively simple game. You look at the risks. We've talked enough about the risks, climate change, soil degradation, depletion of resources. But mostly you get excited about opportunities. Where can we innovate slightly better than the others and move our products into the market in a healthy way? And that's what we need to generate, a language of opportunities around a sustainable and healthy food system. And technology will change everything. Now, this is a picture of a drone, as you may have seen, but drones are now being used for monitoring crops. Satellites are being used to sell microfinancing to smallhold farmers in Southeast Asia, where insurance companies can actually see if there is drought or there is incredible technology in weather prediction, drought prediction, flood prediction. The whole game of how to produce food will change. These things will all happen and business will be the driver of it. And lastly, we need to completely change the way the economy ticks. There is a very, very simple reality, and that is capitalism is driving us off the cliff. If we do not include natural and social capital into the capitalism, we will never make a sustainable world. And in food, the example is the simplest. If you just include the costs that Mother Nature gives to us in producing the food, production prices would need to be increased by 170%. For those of you who calculator works a little slower, that means food would actually need to cost 2.7 times what we pay today because Mother Nature doesn't send us a bill. But if Mother Nature is coming to the end of what she can deliver, we have to start paying those bills. And that change will happen. Carbon pricing is the language for that in climate change. Water pricing and other pricings will come into the rest of the food supply chain before you know it. The Natural Capital Protocol has been built, will be launched in a month from now. In 3 years from now, this will be in corporate governance all around. We can fix this. We know what the solutions are. We have the brains. The companies are ready to go. The science needs to be improved, but we have to do it together. Business alone, Nestlé alone can't do it. All business alone can't do it. We need to work together with academia, with governments, with the consumer voices, and then we can actually crack this. So this was the main course. Now it's time for the dessert, and thank you very much.
Peter, thank you. And a very filling, interesting main course that was as well. Not quite full enough, though. We still do have space for that dessert. And for this, it is time for us to reflect on something that most of us take for granted, most of us who live in these huge metropolises that many people inhabit across the globe. How on earth do cities sustain the masses of people that live within their walls? As we reflect on where we are going with food in this century and where we're heading, we want to leave you with some food for thought to take you back a little bit in time and bring us up to where we are. Our next speaker is an architect, a lecturer, a writer, and has focused her life's work on how we survive in the city. And crucial to that is the food that we eat. Any questions? Her Twitter handle, Carolyn Steel, at Carolyn Steel. Do post your questions via social media. Get that conversation going using the hashtag hashtag Nest Talks, capital N, capital T, to take us on that journey through city life. Please welcome food urbanist, Professor Carolyn Steel.
Hello. How do you feed a city? It's a very interesting question, and it's one that we don't actually ask very often. We take it for granted if we come to a wonderful conference like this, thank you very much for inviting me, that we're going to drift out very shortly and there are going to be lovely little canapés and cocktails and food will be there. But how did it get here? Who produced it? How is it transported? And these things are invisible to us, so it's interesting if you look at an image like my favourite one, actually, the one behind me, of Siena in the 14th century, when these issues were very much visible. This is Ambrogio Lorenzetti's Allegory of the Effects of Good Government, and I would have put the title on, but I ran out of space on this very, very horizontal screen. But it's an interesting title, The Allegory of the Effects of Good Government. Now, what do you see? Now, I'm an architect, so when I saw this wonderful image when I was, 20 years old or something, I thought, that's a very beautiful image of Siena, isn't it? And lovely countryside. And I looked at it for a bit, and then I wandered off somewhere else. And it was only a very painful 25 years later or something when I'd realized that there was something missing in the way I was seeing the world. And I came back to see this image. Did I realize it's really an image about food? And I've only got 13 minutes, and I could spend about 10 times that long just talking about this single image. But if you look closely, you can see huntsmen leaving the city to go and maybe shoot a boar for dinner, sheep wandering around in the city. The sort of the symbolism of a relationship that goes across this very dramatic wall in the middle, which is about symbiosis and connection. And the fact that actually this landscape, which by the way looks very much like the landscape still looks if you go to Siena, and I should mention that this image sits in the council hall, the Sala dei Nove, the main council hall in Siena, and if you look out of the window, that's what you see. But it's actually a landscape that's made by the city for the city. It's an artificial landscape, it's a productive landscape. And then you look again at the title of the image, The Allegory of the Effects of Good Government. What is that telling us? It's actually telling us that if we live in cities, as you all know, more of us in the world now do than live in the countryside, we have to take care of this connection, because if we don't, catastrophe will follow. Now, that's pretty obvious, isn't it? Actually, when you think about it. In fact, everything I say is completely obvious. But it's interesting how sometimes things are too big to see. And the more obvious, sometimes the more invisible. And there are reasons why we don't get this connection anymore. I mean, this is, if you like, what a modern Laurent Setti might look like. That's my hometown of London. Here's the landscape, one of the many landscapes that feeds me, and I have to thank, at this point, Guy and Peter for doing about half of my talk for me and giving you the sort of the full story about how the global food system has now evolved. I call this the urban paradox because, of course, as humans, we need each other. I mean, it's great to be talking to all of you in this room, and it'd be very sad if I was on my own. So I'm a fan of cities, actually. But we also need nature. And the paradox is that the more we move into the city, the further and further away we get from nature. And in fact, food is really the one very, very clear way that we can see what that connection is. I often find the shorter the amount of time I've got to talk, the longer I like to go back in history. So very briefly, I'd like to take you back about 5,500 years ago to the evolution, in fact, the co-evolution, interestingly, both of cities and agriculture. This is a long story, but essentially, grain is the only food that we've ever discovered capable of feeding urban populations. And in fact, early cities, like this one, were in fact enlarged, complicated farming communities, essentially. And if you look at the way they've fed themselves, it's very simple. They're very small, that's about 500 meters across. They're surrounded by farmland. There's a river for irrigation, transport, and also nutrition, because the river brought all the goodness to the land. So this is city 0.10, if you like. It's the first way cities ever found of feeding themselves. And most early cities followed this model. Of course, famously, one city bucked the trend, Rome, had 1 million citizens by the first century AD. So how do you think a city like this fed itself? How do we feed ourselves now? Well, I'll give you the answer, because I don't have time to wait. Food miles. We think of food miles as a modern phenomenon, but they're not, actually. Any city beyond about 30,000, about the population, in fact, of 14th century Siena, would have had to have got its food from a lot further away. The easiest way of doing that in the ancient world was by sea, because it was about 50 times cheaper to bring the food in by sea than over land. And if you think about the problem of feeding a city, there's not only the problem of actually producing the food, we do that through farming and grain production explicitly, but you also have to physically get it in. Now, if Rome hadn't had access to the sea, and indeed, if it hadn't successfully defeated Sicily, Carthage, and then Egypt, it would have run out of food. In fact, it was fed on a just-in-time basis, just like modern cities are. Now, I could talk again for another few hours about how Rome fed itself, because it's fascinating. But actually, if you look at the results of the way it fed itself, it effectively expanded the empire and, in the end, denuded the empire of nutrition in order to feed itself. You could say the city ate itself to death, in fact. So cities in the past designed a landscape with which they could feed themselves, and they very often ate themselves to destruction. But the opposite's also true. The way cities fed themselves also shaped the city. So my hometown of London, about 500 years ago, is very interesting. You can see that all surrounding the city, which is still very compact, there are market gardens. Fruit and vegetables were always grown in the city fringes because those are the one food that it was very difficult to transport, so they needed to be grown close to the city. Grain, the most important food, was coming in mostly by river because it's extremely heavy and bulky, and it's very difficult to bring enough grain in overland. So most was coming into the two main river ports of Queenhithe and Billingsgate. It's trying to make its way up into Cornhill, where, as the name tells you, it was being traded. And in fact, every city that evolved before the railways, you can do this with. You can actually just get out an old map and you can start looking for streets with food names on them. They will be there. Billingsgate, famously, London's fish market. Of course, the fish are also coming in by river. And in fact, Billingsgate still operated on that site until 1984. So it was on that site for more than 1,000 years, which is pretty extraordinary when you think about it. One little fish market feeding what was by then a city of something like 8 million people. But this is another very interesting thing about food ways or pathways, is when they're established, they very rarely move. So once you've got a market somewhere, it tends to stick around. Meat, of course, is different because animals could provide their own transport into the city because they just walked in. Most of London's meat came from Scotland and Wales, way off the map up there, but they were coming into the city from the northwest, which is why Smithfield, which is still London's meat market today, was where the livestock were traded. And if we look at that market, we can see that it was a very visceral, organic, visible thing feeding a city in the pre-industrial world. In fact, if you lived in a city like this, there's no way you could be ignorant of where your food came from, because there it was, mooing and bleating outside your window. So the organic nature of the city and the difficulty of feeding it dominated urban development until this thing came along. This is the first railway ever built. It's the London to the Liverpool to Manchester Railway, built in 1831. Actually built to transport coal, but of course, as soon as the railway was there, they thought, wow, we can actually have people going on this thing, farm animals. I've called this goodbye to geography, because this is the point at which everything changes. No longer are cities constrained. They can now go as big as they like, any shape they like, anywhere they like. And two other things change as well. Food, having been extremely visible and in the heart of the city, suddenly becomes invisible. And last but not least, the allegory of the effects of good government, the relationship between politicians, city authorities, and the food systems begin to split apart. So we have agri-sprawl. We have the railways opening up the American Midwest, enormous grain gluts for the first time in history. What do you do if you've got too much grain? You feed it to animals, of course, and then you feed the animals to city dwellers. So this is when the relationship between meat-eating and city dwelling begins to be linked. And of course, the UN FAO has now said we're in the middle of a livestock revolution, which is linked to urbanization. Of course, trains were just the beginning. People began building cities where nobody in their right minds even tries to walk. In fact, I've been stopped by police twice in America for walking. Excuse me, ma'am, you appear to be lost. I'm terribly sorry, I'm English, I don't really understand. So you don't walk to market to buy your food if you live in a place like this. You drive in a car to a huge box outside the city, and you meet food in boxes, because of course the food is having to withstand hideous logistical nightmares in order to sort of get to you in an edible condition. And it talks to you, and you like it, and you buy it, and you come home, and she's going, I didn't mean to buy all this, I only went out for a pint of milk. And all of this is going to go into the fridge and go off. Well, not all of it, but quite a lot of it. This is the beginning of the waste that Peter talked about, our disconnection with food. And of course, just as industrial food systems evolved, and they stopped being really the core and the heart of the city, we get what I call the eviscerated city, no longer markets in the middle full of food, but actually huge areas of food desert. The red areas here in this map of New York are the Bronx, Harlem, the east part of Brooklyn, where the poor people live, where you have to walk more than 500 meters to get any fresh food. And of course, the world is going this direction. Why? Because there's huge embedded profit in this kind of food, the industrialized model, also the westernized model, which is a kind of lowest common denominator food that everybody loves. I'm nearly running out of time, so I'm going to really speed up now. What do we do about this? Well, it's not a new question. In fact, it's always been hard to feed cities. So really from the beginning, people have been saying, how do we do this? How do we keep it going? Plato did, Thomas More did, Ebenezer Howard did. Ebenezer Howard, if you don't know the Garden City model, is a whole series of little city-states linked by railway. So it's basically Thomas More with railways, effectively. I can give you much more detail outside when we have more time. Of course, people are now saying, can we bring food production back into the middle of the city? The answer is no, we can't. Why not? Because that's the urban carbon paradox, as previously discussed. And in fact, this is quite depressing, and like Peter, I don't like to depress people. So the problem is, this is utopian thinking. This is, let's find a silver bullet to answer this question of how to feed cities. There isn't one. What there is a way of thinking that says that actually food shapes our lives and everything about our lives. And if we understand that, we can use food as a really positive tool to do it better, to make better citopias. Citopia is a word that just simply means food place. So if we look at the way we feed ourselves, do we eat together? Do we have meals around a table? Do we meet humans in the middle of the city? Do we allow cows to eat grass? I'm sure Nestlé does. In fact, I know you do, sometimes. CAFOs, concentrated feeding animal operations. This is what happens when you feed grain to cows. You pump them full of antibiotics. That's 160,000 cows wandering around in their own manure. Do we take the human out of the business of buying and selling food and just drive to boxes in the name of efficiency? Are we so busy we can't afford to take time to eat? 20% of meals in America are now eaten in cars. Given that we evolved around the sharing of food, what does that tell you about the way society is going? Now, all of this is to do with the fact that we don't really see food and therefore we don't really value it. And of course, we outsource the true cost of feeding ourselves. So what happens when you see the true value of food? Well, it usually takes a crisis to show us this. London during the Second World War, Havana after the fall of the Soviet Union, Detroit after all the cars left. What happened? People went back to growing food because it was clearly the most important thing they needed to do. We need to get this vision back and realize it's still the most important thing in our lives, even though it may not appear to be. Can we do it better? Well, again, an infinite discussion we can have later, but there's one example I find quite interesting, Almere Oosterwold, where the Dutch architects, MVRDV, are actually trying to build a new city with food in mind. So they ask you, do you want a farm? Do you want a house? Do you want a factory? And they're trying to put it all into a big picture. So this is a kind of way of seeing the world. And really what I want to leave you with is that food is the most important thing in all our lives that we share and that we produce. If we learn to see the world this way, it changes and we can make a much, much better world to do with shared values, actually. The true value of food. And thank you very much for listening. There's much more up here. Thanks.
Thank you. Buy the book, then you'll find out more. It's been a really fascinating journey, certainly for me, I'm sure for everybody else in this room. We've looked at this obsession, as Eve was talking about, with food that we have, and I'm sure it's not just the millennials in this room that will be Googling food porn when they go home tonight. But balanced against our Western world's obsession with food, we have this awful, ironic situation where millions of people are obese at the same time as millions of people are starving. It is an imbalance that we have to do something about. The human race, we have to wise up to the fact that the human race, the human population is expanding at a disproportionate increase while the planet itself, the size of the planet stays the same. There are things we have to do about it, and in this room we have the power and the ability to make decisions. We need food security, as that guy was talking about, and we need to set targets, as Peter was talking about. We need those targets now. Apologies for not being able to answer all the questions that were coming in via social media, but as I said, if you use the Twitter handles and if you carry on outside this room using those handles of our very wonderful speakers that we've had up on stage today, they will endeavour to answer those questions. Even Carolyn, who hasn't totally embraced social media, she will be on it like a bonnet this afternoon. And they are all staying around for the cocktail reception afterwards. I hope you will too. Collar them, answer the questions that you want answering. And Luis will be giving a few words as well. So please do stay around for the next hour or so. 150 years of history is an incredible landmark. No small feat for any company. And I think the fact that Nestlé is prepared to put on this conference today to address some of the really difficult questions that we've got facing the world at the moment says a lot for the fact that they are here today. It explains why Nestlé is still here as a company. So congratulations for actually facing some of those topics. It is about accepting that change has to happen, adapting to the times that we live in. So thank you for that. Thank you as well to all of you for coming here today. It has been enlightening. I hope you enjoy the cocktail reception for those of you who are staying a little later as well. Thank you for coming, and we will see you next door shortly.